So welcome to module 5.5, and in this module we'll see the pass 2 of the assembler. So what is the input to this pass 2 is that dot inter file. So myproc dot inter file, and as you have seen in the previous module, it is completely no comments are there and no white spaces are there. So what we will see in this file is two types of commands, the CA instruction or the C instruction, right? And those are the things that are put into this file. Symbols, all the symbol table is available to us, and so we will see at symbol or at constant. The moment I see at symbol, now we know how to extract the symbol, we have already done. Take this symbol to the symbol table, look up the symbol table and get back the address, and that address you actually, that address will be in decimal, so you convert it to binary. So there is a routine that will convert decimal address to binary. So after that, it will give you a 14-bit binary or whatever. So because these things would be 15-bit binary, because this will be, and these are all, both the symbols and constants are non-negative decimal in the range of 0 to 32767. So in the range of 0 to 2 power 15 minus 1, right? So when the moment, so the first character will be at, because we have decommented, we have d white space. So the moment I see an at, then I see whether it's a symbol or a constant. You check whether the first character is between 0 to 9, and then if it is a symbol, go to the symbol table, get the address and convert it to binary, and then you put an instruction which is 0 followed by that 15-bit binary. If it's a constant, you convert it to binary and put it as 0 to 15-bit. So this will be the assembled instruction for that. Now the next thing that you may see is a C command. C command will be of the form destination is equal to computing semicolon jump, and either destination or jump will be missing, right? If it is a jump instruction, I will have comp semicolon jump, and if it is compute instruction, then it will be destination equal to comp, okay, destination equal to comp. So what we do is, first we start scanning, we do not know whether when we start scanning the past command, like I have d equal to d plus m, first I am looking at d, at this point I will never know that this is a compute instruction or it is going to be a jump instruction. Because I could also have D colon JZ, I only seen D. So I will start filling up two components, one is called the compute component, another is called the destination component, another is called the jump component. So now I will make a compute component, this also a string, I will just put D on the destination component, and I will also put D. The moment I see equal to, then I know that this is a computation instruction, so I will remove off this. So I know that destination is equal to D, and I will now start populating comp here, and the comp will now become D plus M, whatever is that till the end of the string. But on the other hand, if I this is what will happen here. So I start with destination is D, and parallelly comp also is D, and the moment I see equal to here, then I know that this is destination equal to comp. So what, so I will retain D here, and comp I will now populate it with D plus M. In this case, again I will start with destination as D and comp as D. In the previous case, comp will become D plus M, and of course the jump, the 3 bits, there are 3 bits which basically talk about jump, and those will become 0, 0, 0. Right? This is done. So now in the case of this D colon, I will start with dest equal to D, I will also start with comp equal to D. The moment I see this semicolon here, immediately I will make destination is also 3 bits, I will make destination as 0, 0, 0 and the jump as JZ. So this is how we basically do the C command. So at the end of this level of parsing, I will have something for some string for dest, comp and jump, right? And if it is a computation instruction, jump will be 0, 0, 0. If it is a jump instruction, then the destination will be 0, 0, 0. Now this string, I take it to a routine, which will translate, which is basically implementing the table, right? The table that we have seen in the past, right? So D plus M means what? So D plus M means there'll be some bit pattern for this. This will give you those A bit plus those 6 bits C1, C2 to C5, C6. This will determine the 3 destination bits. And this will determine the 3 jump bits. So this will become 3 plus 7, 10 plus 3, 13 bits. And for the C instruction, the first 3 bits are 111. So the moment I see a C command, now I put the first 3 bits as 111. From the dest string, from the comp string, I'll populate the 7 bits, including A, C1 to C6. And then the dest will populate D1, D2, D3. And the jump will populate J1, J2, G3. So we have to just do a string matching to do this. And there are some tricks to make it, there are some care that we can take to make it more robust. Now, this is how I implement pass 2. Now, let us see the code for pass 2. So, this is where this is the code for pass 2, just to give. So, I am now opening up the intermediate file for reading, and of course, the output file will be .hack. And I am reading again fgetters. I am using fgetters. I am reading it one after another, one by one. And then I go and do a command type. What is this command type? The first character is at, it is a command. If the first character is not at, it is a C command. All commands are now removed and all, right? Now, if it is an A command, immediately I go and check if it is at of a constant or at of a, you know, symbol. And if your first character is less than 0 or greater than 9 character, then it means it's a symbol. So we just go and extract that symbol. Extract that symbol means just copy all the things starting from that point till slash n, and then you go and do this contain get address of the symbol. This contain get address will find out the address. First, it will go and check whether that symbol is contained in the symbol table. If it is, then it will get you the address for that, right? And if it is not contained in the symbol, then you print an error. So this is very, very important, right? So you print an error saying this is a symbol which is not there. Otherwise, if it is, and after you get that address, you convert to binary. Convert to binary is just nothing but keep dividing by 2 and writing the remainder, and that is. So that will fill up this 15 bits of this HUT instruction. The first bit is 0, A instruction, the remaining things. If the command is constant, then please note that this is a string, right? So you have to convert that constant string into actually a decimal constant. That's what we are doing here, right? And then that decimal constant, you just convert to binary. And this assembly instruction that you see is that 16-bit, string where we populate each bit accordingly as we have seen. In the case of E instruction, this 0 to 15, the 15th bit will be 0 and the remaining 15 bits will be filled by this convert to binary. Convert to binary is a very simple routine, we can write it. Now, if it is a C instruction, that's what we are seeing here. Then we have these three components, dest, comp and jump. We have input dest, input comp and input jump. So we basically extract, we start here, right? We start, as I told you, we start populating both int dest and int comp, and at some point of time when we find it is equal to, we make, if it is equal to, then we make jump as 0, right? If it's equal to, I make we again start doing for imp comp. I retain that imp dest, but again I make k equal to 0. As you see here, I basically redo the comp, right? As we had mentioned. So we start by populating both dest and comp as I scan through the string, but if I see equal to, I redo the comp while retaining the dest. and your jump becomes 0 0 0, okay. And but if I encounter a semicolon, that is a semicolon, then I retain the comp, I make that dist as 0 0 0, and the remaining things become jump. So at the end of this parsing, I know what is dist, what is jump, and what is comp, the string. Now that we go and do here, then we have this very interesting. So this is the, if I say JJT, then I know it is 001. I get the corresponding 3-bit equivalent for every jump, and this is there in the table. I encode this table. Similarly, I also get for the destination code. If the destination is M, I know D, MD, but MD, some can write it as DM. Similarly, AM, somebody can write it as MA also. AD can be written as DA. AMD can be written as ADM, MAD, MDA, DAM, DMA, all possible. For all these things, the same bit pattern can come. So this will make the, you know, otherwise the assembler fellow has to remember which alphabet. If I just put MAD alone, then and all these combinations are missing, then this assembler will not assemble that particular thing. So we have to make it robust, all combinations. So this gives more flexibility for person who is actually writing the assembly code to put the destination like this. But this becomes a slightly more complex when we go for the compute part, right. This is the other table. Now if I want 0 as a compute, then this is the 7 bits 0 1 0 1 0 1 0, like that 1 minus 1 DA, not DA minus 1. This is the table that we had for calculating those 6 bits. But then I could have D plus 1, I also have 1 plus D, A plus 1, 1 plus A, M plus 1, 1 plus M, D minus 1, minus 1 plus D, A minus 1, minus 1 plus A. So all these combinations I have put. So we had 18 or 28 combinations that we saw, now we have more than that. So all these combinations, not much, but this is well. So now we get, we assemble the instruction and then we output that instruction. So this is how we do the pass two. So this is a very, very simple code. You can spend just 1 or 2 hours, you can finish it, but you will also revise lot of things about C, right. C as a programming language, or use other language like C++, Java, lot of things that we can learn here. Lot of points you can also think where if there is an error, then we need to highlight that error, right. So we need to write an assembler which is very friendly for development, and one of the most important thing is that we need to recover from errors. Recover from error means this is the error, so this is where there is a problem, you stop there, right. You can't say that there is an error and that get away. You should pinpoint to that error, and that is something which is the basic necessity of writing such type of system software, right. And the last thing that I want to say before we wind up this is that we have been using something called fgetters, right. Now what will fgetters do? It will read from your file, whatever that full line it will read, one line, and it will put it into this buffer called next command. This next command is some one character array, as you see here, which can hold up to say some 80 characters or 90 characters, okay. Now this will just basically, your fgetters will basically full this up, right. But one of the thing is, suppose my input file has more than max char per line, this fgetters will not check for it, it will just go and overwrite things, right. And this is what we call as buffer overflow. The word that we use is buffer overflow. Right, this is basically buffer overflow, and what is the consequence of buffer overflow? Just because we are not checking this down the line, this buffer overflow has been the major source of hacking into systems. There are today, as you see, One of the major issues that we are talking is about cyber security, information security, and how does these cyber attacks happen, how these they happen because somebody can get access into your system, and how do people actually get access into your system? They go it by hacking your system, and one of the most biggest of the vulnerabilities that allow somebody to hack into your system is what we call as buffer overflow. And what is buffer overflow? One of the example is this fgetters. Though I say that next command is restricted to some 80, max char per line is 80 here, 80 characters. If the input file has 85 characters, this will still copy from next command 0 to next command 79, but then some locations will be there after that, it will go and overwrite those things. Fgetters does not check this. So, in an uncontrolled environment, like you write a software which is going to be used by somebody from the internet, you cannot use these type of functions which doesn't do a proper check, right? But this is a very controlled environment. This is nobody is going to directly use the assembler, but there is, if you see the software stack, there is somebody who is going to use the assembler, and that there is only one, that the interpreter which is going to use the assembler. The output of the interpreter is going to be fed into the assembler, and the interpreter can take care that such type of overflows doesn't happen. So this is a very controlled environment. So in a controlled environment we can use, but in an uncontrolled environment this can potentially cause a cyber attack, right? It can become a vulnerability which can be exploited to create a cyber attack. So this is something that is very, very interesting that we need to talk of as a part of this course. So, I hope you have a good understanding of how to go about doing the pass 1 and pass 2. And as a teacher, I really want to practice and then preach. I have written the code, right? I am showing you the code, but this is a C code. You can write much better code in C++ or Java, which is more object oriented and easy. But if you don't know this, don't worry, you know C. But if you don't know C, then this is the time where you learn C. And the way you learn C is, there is a book called Cunningham Ritchie. I have learnt it 35 years before. Such a beautiful book. It has seen generations, at least 3 generations of students. I say every decade is a generation. So, we have seen 3 generations of students. Please take that book. But how do you read that book? Now, you have to read entire thing. There is nothing like reading a programming language. You start coding. So, there will be a lot of examples and you start doing the example problem. But most importantly, do the exercise problems. If you do the exercise problem, you do that Cunningham Ritchie, basically 200 pages, 250 pages, if I remember correct. And if you do all the exercise problems there, take a month of time, you can learn any other programming language. It's my opinion. If you know C, you can quickly grasp the other languages very quickly, right? C is a very fundamental language. And the way to learn C is to go through Cunningham Ritchie's book, which can give you very deep insight into how do you go and do C. And C will, knowing this programming language is very important from your professional career point of view, placement, whatever, right? And even if you want to teach, the clarity of how a software has to be designed, that clarity comes when you do lot of programming. If you don't do programming, you are out, right? You can never claim to be an engineer. So, with this, I finish off this module 5.5, and we will meet in the next module 5.6. Thank you.